really, really great, and we're glad to host you today. We hope you see something that excites you, and you'll tell everybody about it. I often am told that we within Langley don't do a good job of telling the world all the great things we do, so maybe you can do that for us today. So we hope that you really see things that excite you. I've got some slides here and some pretty pictures, which I will show briefly. But before I do that, I want to tell you something that's really, really important to me. I love my job, and as Kathy said in the introduction, this is my third career. I chose to come here, and I've been here 25 years. And for me, every day is living the dream. And you might want to know why. It's all about the mission of this agency. What could be more compelling than understanding the origins of the universe, to understand the origins of life? What could be more compelling about the human destiny to explore space? And many of us believe that the human species should be a multi-planet species. So what could be more compelling than that? And if you look at the role of transportation in the development of everything we know about in the world, transportation has become synonymous with freedom. And without transportation, we wouldn't have the economic development that we have. And so our mission in civil aviation is one of all about quality of life. Can you imagine a world maybe 50 years from now in which the Jetson cartoon is real and we are able to fly in personal air vehicles anywhere we want to, anytime we want to, at an affordable rate? We don't have to be a trained pilot to do it because it's so autonomous that anyone can fly. Wouldn't that be a great world to live in? Wouldn't we really enjoy that? And so when I look at our mission, I find it to be very compelling, and I jump out of bed every morning and run into the office as fast as I can to interact with the neat people we have here at the center to do the great things we do. And I got to tell you, I did go to Virginia Tech as an engineer. What I was really good at, my unique gift, was math. I have an affinity for math, so that made some of the engineering work fairly easy for me. But I didn't come by engineering principles easy. I didn't always understand the concepts right away. I had to spend a lot of time working on it. I had to get experience before I did it. So for me, I am absolutely in awe of the technology. So for me, every day is just an exciting day as we strive to master the technology and master the work we do. And really, it is all about outcomes. What we want to do at Langley, what we are also deeply committed to, doing the kind of research that leads to compelling outcomes that makes a real difference in the life of real human beings. Because for us, it's really actually all about people. And the technology is the medium we use as we engage real people. Langley has been here since the beginning. Langley was established in 1915 as a civil aeronautics research center for the federal government. The military research center at Dayton Flight Laboratory was established in the same period of time. I think they beat us to open doors by about 3 months, but between our two centers, we have the historic government legacy of aeronautics research and aviation. Our first wind tunnel opened here in 1917, so as you're driving around Langley, the skyline is really defined by our wind tunnels. And we have a very broad suite of wind tunnels that allows us to cover the entire speed regime, from subsonic, transonic, supersonic, and hypersonic flight. We use those wind tunnels to develop technology that we use both for aviation as we fly through our atmosphere, but also in rocket vehicles as we launch through the atmosphere to space. And then when we have missions in which we enter the atmosphere of another planet like Mars, we do the entry, descent, and landing work so that we know how to enter those planets safely. Part of the legacy of the center is the first Viking missions in the mid-70s, which actually was the first to land on Mars. They were Langley projects. We conceived of those projects, led those projects. So we have a rich heritage up in the space side of the house within Langley and the nation. This is an artist rendering that captures two things. It kind of captures our vision of the center. And if you look around the bottom, for those of you that are close enough to see that, those are a couple of new buildings that we're building in our new town concept. And we're revitalizing the infrastructure of the center. So you will see our first new town building there. And in the sky Well, we kind of did an artist rendering to kind of capture our multi-mission everywhere from new aircraft, new vehicle configurations that are different than current aircraft that fly in the atmosphere for transportation. And then you can see a lot of space vehicles there flying that go through the atmosphere into space. Now, somebody has said that's dark clouds on the horizon, and that's kind of like, yeah, not really. that's our best artist rendering of what the future could look like. One of the projects that we're working here at the center is very, very important. This is the Mars Science Lab. Mars Science Lab is going to be launched the day after Thanksgiving on November 25th, if weather permits. And it is going to have about a 9-month voyage to Mars, and it is going to land the Spirit rover.
Curiosity.
On the surface of Mars, it is the largest vehicle that we've ever landed on the surface of Mars, so it has unique challenges. But this rover has 10 different science instruments, and the work of science that this rover is going to do is all about determining if Mars ever hosted life. Are there microbials or elements of life? Biology for which there is an indelible footprint on the surface of Mars. So there are 10 different instruments that are doing a lot of science. The work that we're doing to enable this mission is the technology that allows the vehicle to safely enter the Martian atmosphere and land safely. And that's a bit of a challenge because it goes in at a very, very high speed and has to slow down to land safely. But the atmosphere of Mars is not as dense as the atmosphere on Earth. It's really hard to do that. And so we're constantly developing technology that we refer to as entry, descent, landing. And that's the unique role we play in partnership with the Jet Propulsion Laboratory in California for this mission. This is some instrumentation work we're doing here at the center. And we're going to instrument what's called the thermal protection system of the capsule that's going to enter Mars, so we can get some real-time data that will allow us to characterize the atmosphere more effectively. Because what we ultimately want to do is land humans on Mars. That means we have to live with 100 times more mass on Mars than we have ever landed before, and we do not know how to do that. Period. So we have got to develop the technology that will allow us to land humans safely on Mars. So that's an example of a technology challenge, and that's why Mars landing is a 2035 goal rather than a 2015 or a 2025 goal. So it's really exciting, but some of these things are long-term endeavors. This is an example of a vehicle here that we worked on in the mid-80s, and this concept has been adopted by industry as we try to develop the next generation launch vehicles that help us replace the space shuttle. So we have a commercial development activity underway in which we have encouraged industry to develop their own vehicle that we can use to go into low Earth orbit and get to the International Space Station. So we're working closely with a company called Sierra Nevada, who is working on developing a lifting body like a vehicle similar to this that can go to the International Space Station. We also do a lot of work in space science. This is an infrared image of the Earth. Going back to the mid-70s, Langley has led the development of science instruments. We have had at least one science instrument in orbit around the Earth continuously since 1975. And we're continually collecting data about the atmosphere. For example, our work was the first work in the early 90s that identified the hole in the ozone layer. And we were able to carefully document that led to a lot of changes as we got fluorocarbons out of the atmosphere that was creating the depletion of the ozone layer. More recently, our work is all focused on radiation, the radiation budget, because many of us believe that climate change is occurring, and we want to understand why it's occurring and where it's headed so that that can inform public policy. And so this is an example of data that was collected from a space satellite instrument that we call CERES, C-E-R-E-S, all cap letters. And the C is for clouds and the R is for radiation. We're now up to Series FM6, the FM stands for flight mission, first one was launched in 1997. We just launched the FM5, I think, about 10 days ago. So we have a new instrument that's on its way into space to continue this data collection so that our government officials will be able to be better informed as to what the public policy is that we need, all about climate and climate protection. We also are working on advanced concepts. I teased you with the vision of the Jetson. That's kind of like the holy grail of civil transportation. That's been off. We are also working on another concept for large transport aircraft. This is a concept vehicle for supersonic transport that would fly at perhaps twice the speed of sound, Mach 2, and would allow us to do transcontinental flights much faster than we currently do that. We're beginning to work with industry to develop this technology, and we're also working on vehicles that would fly subsonically, so we would have domestic flights. And we're also working on an enabling concept for air transportation. We're trying to put in place a new air traffic management system. Right now, our air traffic management system is ground-based, human-centric, and it is not scalable, and so that constrains the capacity that we have. It's all airport-centric and hub-and-spoke-centric. We can imagine a world in which each airplane has onboard sensors that has the ability to sense all of the aircraft, to know where it's going, and to be able to provide the pilot real-time information so that aircraft can fly optimized routes. And that way we could increase the capacity because it's not constrained by a ground-centric, human-centric control system. So that's a bit off, that's a bit ways off, but a lot of very interesting research underway to develop both the vehicle-based technology as well as ground-based technology so that we can increase capacity and move safely. So those are some of the things that we're working on. You've got a really attractive agenda for the rest of the day. You've got to be carried around everywhere and see lots of things and take lots of pictures and tweet back to your friends and your tweet networks and tell them Charlie said that we're doing great things for the country.